Now, without further ado, it is my great honor to introduce to everyone Dr. Vanda Wilcox. Dr. Wilcox is an adjunct professor of history at John Cabot University in Rome, Italy. She received her PhD from Oxford University, where she focused her studies on morale and discipline in the Italian army during the First World War. Her research and educational interests lie with the Italian experience of the era, as well as themes surrounding imperialism, pop culture, memory, and sports culture. She has written several works on the Italian army during the Great War, included, but not limited to, Morale in the Italian Army during the Great War, and Italy in the Era of the Great War. Her most recent work, The Italian Empire and the Great War, was published by Oxford University Press in the UK this July and was released in the United States this summer. Ladies and gentlemen, Dr. Vanda Wilcox.
Hi, and thank you so much for that very kind intro. I'm just gonna share my presentation with you. I'm super excited to be here with you tonight. I only wish that I was actually in Kansas City in the beautiful museum rather than at home. But I'm super excited to be talking to you anyway. And I'm gonna talk about a couple of different aspects of the war today on the Italian front. So just over 100 years ago, on the 4th of November, 1918, an armistice came into operation on the front between Italy and Austria-Hungary, where they'd been fighting since May 1915. And the war which Italy had won, after such struggle, is idealized as a war of unity, as a war that was going to bring all Italians together to an unprecedented degree and create a new nation and a new people. And this poster, which is actually the poster that I chose as the cover of my most recent book, one of the reasons I chose it was I love the way that this symbolizes this idea of a war of unity. What we can see here is this the idealized symbolic form of Italy as a winged figure. And she's holding out her sword so that all Italians, all members of the national community can swear loyalty. And you can see the various hands reaching out. They include the bare arm of the worker, perhaps an agricultural worker. They include the middle and upper class, nice cuffs and elegant suit jackets. They include the rough sleeve of a factory worker. But also in this picture, we see a rare acknowledgement of the fact that it's not just a national war. It's also an imperial war, because to one side, we also see a black hand reaching across to swear the oath of loyalty to Italy, recognizing that Italy fought this war not just as a nation, but actually as an empire, as a colonial empire. So this is this idea of this as a war of unity, as a war that was going to complete the process of national unification. The idealized narrative of the war is that it is the moment at which the unredeemed lands, as they're known, the lands which had not been incorporated into Italy during the original process of unification, are finally going to be liberated. So this idea of a war of national redemption, we see illustrated here in this 1915 propaganda poster, that certain pieces of territory which should be Italian were not. So Trento in the Trentino in the north, the city of Trieste and the area around Trieste and Istria over on the eastern border, and sections of the coast down the Adriatic coast in what is today Croatia, in Dalmatia and around the town of Zara. The postcard says 1 million of Italians in Trento, Trieste, Fiume, and Zara are waiting redemption. They're waiting to be brought into the national community. So this is the mythologized version of the war. This is what the war is supposed to be all about. But actually, I want to say yes, but no. That is what the war is about, but that's only a part of the story. I'd like to highlight the gap between this traditional narrative of the war as one of national redemption and unity, And the reality, which is that it's also an imperialist and colonialist war, and it's a war which increases disunity and division in a number of ways. And that has very important consequences for the future. And the title of the series of talks of World War One changed us. I think hopefully by the end of the talk, it will be clear some of the important ways in which this changed Italy and had very significant consequences, not only in Italy itself, but also for the wider world. So the objective of completing national unification, this map hopefully makes reasonably clear the main fighting front of the Italian-Austrian war. So in dotted grey lines, you can see the pre-war borders, and you can see the shape of the original border between Italy and Austria-Hungary. And in the dotted yellow line, you see the furthest advance of Italian troops by October 1917. It's not very far. You can see that a small amount of territory has been captured by the Italians around the Isonzo River. There's very, very bitter fighting all along this front, but really it's a very marginal gain. And in most places, the front line actually still corresponds relatively closely with the border, despite 2.5 years of bitter and intensive fighting. In 1917, October and November 1917, there was a huge Austrian-German assault known as the Battle of Camporetto, and they advance deep into Italian territory, and you can see the red dotted line along the River Piave, and that red dotted line marks the furthest point of the Austrian and German advance in November 1917. This leaves over 150 kilometers, leaves this huge section of Italian land under enemy occupation, Italian civilians under German and Austrian occupation, causes a huge flood of over 1 million refugees into the Italian interior. So it's a very devastating experience for the people of northeastern Italy. By the time the war finally ends a year later, the line has slightly advanced. The Italians have advanced as far as this thick orange line, but they haven't even recaptured all of the lost territory, never mind pushed back into enemy lands. When the armistice is signed at the end of the war, they hastily rush troops off to capture these key objectives, the city of Trento, which you can see here. This is November the 3rd, the same day the armistice is signed, they managed to get Italian troops up to occupy the city of Trento. And here we see a kind of propaganda celebration. We see the crown symbolic figure of Italy being embraced by her daughters. The cities of Trento and Trieste. In their hair, they have the city symbols as kind of hair ornaments, and they embrace their mother. Finally, Italian unification is complete. And it's supposed to be a moment of great celebration. This is something from my own personal collection. This is something that belongs to my great-grandmother. My nonna Vanda was born and raised in Milan. And this came down to me with a collection of other First World War bits and pieces, postcards and so on. And it's a commemorative handkerchief, which is not a thing, I think, that you see a lot of. As you can see, it's in slightly poor condition. But what it depicts is the moment of return. And the slogan says, Siamo di ritorno, abbiamo vinto e viva l'Italia. So we're back. We've won, long live Italy. And we have the ecstatic soldiers returning home and to the embrace of their family. And we have the text of the chief of general staff, Armando Diaz, the text that he proclaimed announcing the victory on November the 4th, 1918, the glory of Italy, and his triumphant remarks upon the formal declaration of victory. So, in theory, they've won, they've got Trento and Trieste, they've got nice commemorative handkerchiefs, it's all good, right? Everything should be going swimmingly and everyone should be very happy. Instead, unfortunately, no, that's not what is happening at all. And the public mood is much more negative. Even before final victory is announced, there is a real anxiety about what's going to happen next. And here we see an incredibly important newspaper front page from the 24th of October. So it's less than two weeks before the armistice is signed. It's the Corriere della Sera, which is Italy's newspaper of record. It's the number one most important daily. It's a sort of liberal centrist newspaper, I guess. It's maybe like the New York Times of Italy. And their headline here, Vittoria Nostra non sarai mutilata. Our victory must not be mutilated. Now, actually, as you can see, what we have here on the front page of the paper, perhaps rather unusually, is a poem. And this is a long poem by the celebrated nationalist Italian poet Gabriele D'Annunzio. He was a leader of the interventionist movement in 1915. He was very keen to get involved in the war from the start. And here he is, as the war's end approaches, expressing his concerns about what's going to happen next. And the idea of a mutilated victory is this fear that Italy isn't going to get its just deserts, that the Italian sacrifice and struggle has been so great and so terrible that it deserves a certain level of recompense. It's worth noticing, by the way, that the Italian military deaths are somewhere between 550 and 600,000. We don't necessarily have precise figures. That's another long story. But roughly the same proportion of the Italian pre-war population as in the United Kingdom are casualties in this war. So it's a huge national sacrifice. It's been a huge war effort. And the idea now is that having won, right, Italy deserves a certain kind of recompense. And unfortunately for the Italians, they're not going to get everything that they'd hoped for. And a big part of that is to do with what happens at the Paris Peace Conference. Here we see some of the leaders of the three main Entente countries. We see Foch and Clemenceau on the left, in the center, Lloyd George. And then we have Vittorio Orlando and Sidney Sonnino in Paris, the two Italian delegates. So Vittorio Orlando, the prime minister, Sidney Sonnino, the foreign minister. And they go to Paris with essentially a mandate from the public to make it all worthwhile. And what that translates to is two things. First of all, claiming all of the territory which they've been promised before the war in the Treaty of London. And secondly, this is very important, claiming the city of Fiume. Now Fiume, which is nowadays called Rijeka, it's a Croatian port. Fiume hadn't been included in the Treaty of London. But by 1919, the public have developed a kind of obsession with the city of Fiume. And they insist that there was a strong clamor in the public sphere, insists that Fiume must be Italian. Now, the actual population of the city itself, just within the sort of city limits, is a majority Italian population. But the second you step outside the city limits, it's surrounded by a basically Croatian hinterland. And it's not part of the Treaty of London. It doesn't look like a majority Italian area to most international observers. And the person who's really not on board with all these Italian claims is Woodrow Wilson. And of course, the American leader had not signed the Treaty of London. The Treaty of London was signed in 1915. Britain and France agreed with Italy what they would give Italy if Italy joined the war, and then they won. Obviously, the USA wasn't part of that because they're not part of the war at that stage. And Woodrow Wilson's idea of national self-determination flies completely in the face of everything that the Italians are hoping for. So they don't get what they want in Paris. That doesn't mean they get nothing. This map highlights the post-war borders. So here we can see the pink line marks what the Treaty of London had offered to the Italians. All of this area around Trento and Trentino in the north, the towns of Caporetto, Gorizia, Trieste. And then the original Treaty of London line had actually gone just on the inside of Fiume. So Fiume had not been asked for, and some sections of the Dalmatian coast, including the town of Zara. Woodrow Wilson says, no, that's far too much. I'm not going to give you that much. I'm certainly not going to give you any extra. The line that Wilson approves and which ultimately is agreed at the Paris conference is the yellow line. And you can see it doesn't look like a lot of territory. And it's not even necessarily particularly useful. There's a lot of nice islands to go on holiday in. I went on my honeymoon in some of those islands, but it's not particularly strategically or economically useful territory, but it's become a matter of national pride. So this is an extremely controversial and divisive issue, and Italian nationalists quite quickly feel betrayed, furious, and the city of Fiume kind of sparks this off. And I think it's a really interesting moment because it's generally seen as a moment of nationalism, of frustrated nationalism. Nationalists want to incorporate the Italian, unify all Italian people inside the national borders, and therefore they want Fiume. But actually, the extent to which Fiume and these extra territories really are Italian is kind of debatable. And this is quite expansionist. It's very hard to justify this in purely national terms. It's also really hard to justify some of the other areas that they're claiming. The northern part of the Trentino is probably better known to most people as the Sud Tyrol. The city of Bolzano is really Bozen. It has a majority German-speaking population. The northern portion of this area here is full of German speakers. How is this Italy? How is this a national claim? So the dividing line between expanding the nation and expanding the state in a less clearly national sense is a bit tricky. The other consequence of this is that this isn't supposed to be a war for unity and to make Italy and Italians, but in fact, at the end of the war, we have an unprecedented disunity because for the very first time, there are significant minorities inside the borders of the Italian nation state. There are Germans, there are Slavs, there are Ladins, there are people who are speaking different languages and have different ethnicities who are now inside this new enlarged Italy. So far from creating greater unity, it's created for the first time a minorities problem or a minorities question within Italy itself. What happens? Well, you may well know, this man here, who is a fascinating and bizarre character, Gabriele D'Annunzio, the poet who coined this phrase of the mutilated victory in the first place, gets together a band of merry men and off they go to Fiume and they seize it in the name of Italy. He leads this group of mainly veterans, a lot of veteran officers, mostly middle class veterans, some young kind of youthful spirits who wanted to join in the war, and the war ended before they had a chance. They seized the city of Fiume in September 1919. You can see here the Italian national flag raised above these crowds in the city centre, and they occupy the city until December 1920, creates this huge national and international crisis. But here we see D'Annunzio addressing some of his troops, and he sets up a political system which in some ways is kind of a prototype of fascism. It's a very significant moment. It suggests that a small number of very determined men willing to take drastic paramilitary action could change the whole destiny of national policy. And this is a lesson that Mussolini pays a great deal of attention to. And we're only a couple of years out of the March on Rome, so the Fiume episode has a number of important legacies. But the idea of the mutilated victory isn't only about Fiume, and it isn't only about national borders. It's also about empire, because I would like to convince you that Italy is always also an imperial and global war. It's not just about the nation state, it's also about empire. Italy starts the war as an empire, it fights the war as an empire, and it has imperial objectives. So in order to think about what is the imperial and global side of the war, there are a number of different areas that we could talk about, and which in my book I talk about. War aims, which I'm going to tell you a little bit more about this evening, war in the colonies. This is something which is often ignored, but actually the Italians are fighting in another theatre, not just the, against the Austrians, but they're also fighting in North Africa, which I'll tell you about in a moment. We could look at the colonial contribution to the war. What are the colonies providing to the Italian war effort. We could look at the expeditionary forces that Italy sends as part of the global allied war effort. So Italians don't only serve in Italy, they're fighting in Albania, they're fighting on the Macedonian front, they're fighting in small numbers, it's true, but they're fighting in the Middle East. They're sent to Russia, both to northern Russia, to the Arkhangel campaign, and they're also sent all the way out to the eastern campaign in the far eastern Russia, where they serve in the Manchurian campaign. In 1918, they're fighting also in France. A whole army corps is dispatched to fight on the Western Front. So they're participating in a global war effort as well, not just the national war that is the more familiar story of the Italian experience of the First World War. And the imperial and global aspect of the war, we also see in the presence of Italian ideas about race, which are undergoing some important transitions in this time period. And they inform the ways in which Italian troops treat the enemy, and they inform the ways in which the Italian troops treat enemy civilians in particular. So there are a number of different strands which I talk about in my book. I can't talk about every part of this tonight, but I want to focus on just a couple of important aspects of the imperial and global side of the war. So first I want to just talk briefly about what's happening in North Africa. This is Italian Libya. The map might be a tiny bit confusing, but in 1911, 1912, Italy had invaded what had previously been the Ottoman region of Libya, or Tripolitania and Cyrenaica, and conquered it. You can see the red dotted line marks the areas that they conquer. So sort of two-thirds of modern day Libya. Starting in late 1914 and early 1915, there's a major insurrection against Italian control. Now, most historians have traditionally dealt with this as purely an internal issue inside of the Italian Empire, not something to do with the First World War. They said, okay, so there's an anti-colonial insurgency. The people, especially of Tripolitania in 1914-15, and then of Cyrenaica in 1516, rise up and fight vigorously against Italian control. But the traditional interpretation is that's not really anything to do with the war. Actually, that's not true. Because although most of the people doing the fighting are the indigenous populations of Tripolitania and Cyrenaica, they are funded by the Central Powers. This is just a nice illustration of the enthusiasm with which Italy had greeted the conquest of Libya. This is a board game in which you get to conquer or reenact the conquest of Libya yourself, if you wanted, which I think is quite interesting. It comes out in 1914. We can see this is something that was a big deal. It was a huge source of national pride. It was a lot of national enthusiasm at home for the conquest and incorporation of Libya. So when in 1915, these insurrections begin, this is a big blow, because Italy is supposed to be this kind of triumphantly expanded imperial power as a result. The Central Powers are funding and leading this effort, this anti-Italian insurrection, in a couple of important ways. So the Ottoman Empire, which would quite like to have this area back, is sending military leaders, including Nuri Bey. He's the younger brother of the Ottoman Minister for War, Enver Pasha. So he's a really important figure, very, very well connected and of the highest rank. And he is dispatched, and he spends pretty much the whole of the war up until early 1918 inside Italian Libya, working with various different tribal groups, religious communities, and so on, to encourage them to fight the Italians more. And this is seen as a way for the Ottoman Empire to distract Italy, it's a way for the Ottoman Empire, in a sense, to fight Italy indirectly by using the troops of Cyrenaica and Tripolitania, so using Libyan forces. Where's the money coming from? Where's the weapons coming from? The ammunition? It's mostly coming from Germany. It's the German and Austrian navies, and particularly submarines, which are resupplying the indigenous anti-colonial movements. So you can see the Italians retain the cities which are marked in blue along the coastline, but you can see that both over in Cyrenaica, the port of Tobruk, and in Tripolitania, Misurata in particular is a very important port, those are in enemy hands. And German submarines are coming in at least once a fortnight, filled to the rafters. I think submarines have rafters, but anyway, filled as full as they can be with cash, with munitions, with machine guns, with rifles. Not always the latest technologies, but things that the Central Powers can find and spare, and money to pay for it all, and radio equipment and all sorts of other bits and pieces. It's all coming in from the Central Powers. Without that Central Powers funding and equipment, there's a good chance that the Italians would have been able to resume control of this area. So what we can say is that this is another theatre, essentially, that the Italians are fighting in. And a number of historians have said it's this Italy's own southern front, or the Libyan theatre of the war. Between 60 and 100,000 Italian soldiers are pinned down fighting in Libya for the entire duration of the war. Now, those are men and resources, of course, that are being used up that the Italians would have been delighted to use elsewhere. But they can't because they're fighting this colonial war, which is part of the wider First World War conflict. So that's one part of the story. The other part of the story is who's doing the fighting. Well, some of the people doing the fighting there are also colonial troops. So it's not only that we have war in the colonies, it's that we have colonial forces fighting there. Just as in the British and French armies, the Italians began to recruit troops of colour in their different African possessions. And the oldest units that they had were from Eritrea. The Eritrean are the, groups are the heart of the Italian colonial forces. But they also have some Somalis, and increasingly from 1911, 1912, they're also recruiting in Libya as well. Here we've just got some images of the Askari from Eritrea. Askari, by the way, is an Italianized version of the Arab word for soldier. And here you can see the poster of the first Eritrean battalion celebrating their own victories. They do a lot of the fighting in Libya. The Italian high command does actually debate, should we deploy some of these African soldiers to our own European front? So obviously, the British are using Indian troops on the Western Front. The French are using West African and North African soldiers on the Western Front as well. There was a debate in Italy, should colonial soldiers be sent to fight against Austria? And the high command is pretty enthusiastic. They actually start training, in particular the Libyan soldiers that they've recruited, in techniques of trench warfare, how to use hand grenades, how to fight on against barbed wire, all this kind of modern tactics and modern methods. But at the last minute, the government blocks this idea. It's particularly the Minister of the Colonies who says, actually, we shouldn't do this. We should not encourage African soldiers under our command to get used to the idea of fighting against a white enemy. It's not advisable for us to deploy these men against the Austrians because essentially it's transgressing against a kind of color line. We need to make sure that these men, they could be used for other kinds of peacekeeping forces. We could use them in Libya, but we can't send them to fight against Austria. So they're not deployed in on the national front, but they are part of the war effort. And by fighting in Libya, these Eritrean Askari free up white soldiers who get sent off to fight in Macedonia and Albania and elsewhere. There's also, if the war had continued into 1919, they would probably have sent some Eritrean forces to fight in the Middle East. That was a planned operation that ultimately didn't go ahead. So this is part of the colonial contribution to the war effort. There are other kinds of colonial contribution that we could talk about. The production of meat, for example, in East Africa, which is a long and really miserable story about how in an effort to extract as much food as possible for the war effort, they induce a kind of man-made famine in bits of Eritrea. We could also talk about workers. There's a couple of thousand Libyan workers who get sent to Italy to work in factories in the war effort. So the colonies are being used to support the war effort as well. And all of these, I think, are parts of the story which tend to get ignored. They tend to get missed out in favour of this narrative that focuses on, you know, the fighting in the high mountains, the fighting against Austria. And these parts of the story, I think, need to be put back in, essentially. There's also the question of war aims. And the war aims that Italy develops in the Eastern Mediterranean, which are really very clearly colonial war aims. So why is Italy interested in the Eastern Mediterranean at all? Well, at the same time as it conquered Libya, it had also conquered a number of islands from Turkey over in the Eastern Mediterranean, chief of which is Rhodes. Here we can see an illustrated Sunday newspaper of the time depicting the Turkish army on Rhodes surrendering to General Amelio. And this became the heart of what is known as the Dodecanese Islands. Here you can just see what that looks like. So we've got Rhodes and a series of other mostly smaller islands, some of which are extremely close to the Turkish coast, like Castel Rosso, others a bit further away. The populations are mixed, majority Greek, Turkish and Jewish minorities there as well. The Italians are supposed to only be occupying these islands temporarily. But what they really want to do is turn that into a permanent colonial possession and use it as a jumping off point to expand into other parts of Turkey and other parts of the Eastern Mediterranean. I apologize if you can hear cat noises in the background. My cat has decided to come and keep us company. Now, this was not a secret set of ambitions. In fact, what I find very interesting is that we can see the issue of Eastern Mediterranean expansion cropping up as early as August 1914. Now, Italy doesn't join the war in August 1914 when everyone else does. Italy declares neutrality in August 1914. The Italians don't decide to enter the war until May 1915. But the Italian ambassador in London has a meeting with the British foreign ambassador in mid-August 1914, and the British are already trying to persuade the Italians that they should join the war effort, that they should join the Entente. And one of the carrots that the British hold out to the Italians, August 1914, is expansion in the Eastern Mediterranean. They say if the Ottoman Empire should be broken up, then maybe Italy could benefit. Well, this is pretty extraordinary because Italy hasn't joined the war yet, but equally the Ottoman Empire also hasn't joined the war yet. So you might think this is a little bit premature. This falls into the fine British tradition of offering people other people's territories. So this is might seem like it's a kind of out there idea, sort of cloud cuckoo land. But what interests me about this is that Italy's ambitions in the Eastern Mediterranean are sufficiently well known that 9 months before they join the war, the British already think of this as a worthwhile offer, as something that might well interest the Italians and get them on side, okay? So it's no surprise that when Italy does join the war, they sign the Treaty of London, and the Treaty of London does not only include national objectives, it includes imperial and colonial objectives. The important Italian historian of the war, Marco Mondini, has called it Italy's paradoxical war because it's presented as the last war of unification, the war to unify all Italy. But actually, they not only demand all these territories that, as we've seen, are full of Germans and Slavs, but in the Treaty of London, they demand territory in Albania, right the way down the Adriatic coast, and they demand full sovereignty over the Dodecanese Islands. So we can see that instead of a temporary occupation, they want a permanent one. And finally, promises of territory in Asia Minor, i.e. Turkey, and colonial compensation. Now, it's a very vague agreement that's signed in 1915. They don't say exactly what colonial compensation there'll be or what territory they might get in Asia Minor, but it's there right from the start. And I think that's important. However, in 1916, 1917, we see a significant escalation of public interest in Italy, in territories in the Middle East, for a variety of reasons. And in April 1917, the Italians managed to negotiate a new deal with France and Britain called the Saint-Jean-de-Maurienne Agreement. They meet at this place in southeastern France, Saint-Jean-de-Maurienne, and they sign this proposed carve-up, if you like, of the Ottoman Empire. So some bits of this map might look familiar to you because this is based on the Sykes-Picot Agreement of 1916. The French were going to get the areas in blue and marked A. The British were going to get the areas in red and marked B. And the Italians are now going to get the green and C areas. So the green area was going to be directly in Italian control, and the C area was going to be under an Italian sphere of influence. That was the plan. Or the proposal of the Saint-Jean-de-Maurienne Agreement. And as you can see, it's a pretty huge chunk of Turkey, the whole basically of southern Turkey, that Italy was hoping to grab for itself at the end of the war. Now, of course, spoiler, this isn't going to happen. Saint-Jean-de-Maurienne is never actually very likely to happen. The French and the British announced in October 1918 that they're not going to go through with this. And I think it's an interesting moment because we have Gabriele D'Annunzio saying our victory must not be mutilated, just at the moment in which the French and the British are saying, ah, do you know what, we're not going to give you all those territories after all. So I think this feeds right into the fear of the mutilated victory. And especially once it becomes clear that the Allied powers do not want to play ball with Italy over Fiume and those territories in the Adriatic, Italian public opinion feels outraged, this is a betrayal, and it's not surprising that they decide to take matters into their own hand. Now, they've already been contributing somewhat to the war in the Middle East. One of the terms of the Saint-Jean-de-Maurienne Agreement is that they will send some troops. We can see here this fur in the hat with the big feathers, the Bersaglieri hat. There's a small Italian contingent sent to fight in the Palestine and Sinai campaigns. And here we see Bersaglieri, Italian troops, accompanying Allenby into Jerusalem in 1917. The Italians actually would have willingly sent more. They've got Carabinieri in training camp in Egypt, as you can see here. They would have willingly sent more if the Brits had been agreeable to that. But when it turns out that neither France nor Britain are very enthusiastic about actually letting Italy have what they want in the Middle East and Turkey. They participate also in the occupation of Constantinople at the end of the war, but they send troops of their own to try to occupy these areas. So in 1919, more than 12,000 Italian soldiers disembark in the southern portion of Turkey in Antalya, which is kind of behind this, one of these information boxes here, to try to secure this land for themselves. On paper, they're going to be given it. This is the map that shows the 1920 Treaty of Sèvres. In reality, this too is not going to happen. By 1922, Italian troops have withdrawn, and that's really the end of that. It's a kind of, you might think, exaggerated goal in the first place, and it doesn't really lead anywhere. But I think it's an important part of what the Italians thought about the war at the time, what they hoped for. And just because it doesn't work from the point of view of the Italians doesn't mean that it shouldn't be a part of the story. There's one last aspect of the Italian imperial and global war that I'd like to talk to you about, which is the Italian global diaspora at war. Now, you might be thinking, how is this part of an imperial narrative? And I'll explain that in one moment. But the first thing that we can say is that any nation like Italy, which has a major global diaspora, cannot really be understood in purely narrow national terms. We cannot write the history of Italy in this time period without thinking about the diaspora. Between 1870 and 1914, around 14 million Italians had emigrated. Now, many Italians went abroad and then they came back home again. It was a sort of temporary emigration. So there's still 6 or 7 million living outside Italy in 1914, of which it is estimated that there are about 1.2 million men of military age. What we can say for sure is that 700,000 are called up, of which 300,000 return to fight. So that's one in four of the men of military age. The reason that they're not all called up is that some of them can't be identified. They can't be located by the Italian authorities. The Italian authorities would have wanted to call up all 1.2 million. If you're an Italian citizen, you were liable for conscription wherever in the world you were. That included if you were an emigrant or the descendant of an emigrant. Okay, so second generation, you had citizenship, you were still in theory liable for your military service. But many of those men either have emigrated illegally or they've kind of dropped off the records, they've not left a forwarding address. So not all of them can be called up. Of those who are called up, just over 300,000 return to Italy, and nearly 400,000 charges of draft evasion are issued to those who do not return. This is just to let you know where the returnees come from. 103,000 returning from North America, around 50,000 from South America, well over 100,000 from Europe, and smaller numbers from North Africa. There's a lot of Italians in Tunisia and Egypt, and a tiny, tiny percentage, sort of like 1,000 from Asia and the Pacific and Australia. So about 50% are coming back across the Atlantic from North or South America, and the remainder predominantly Europe and North Africa. So they're conscripts, they're not volunteers, but they kind of have a choice. You know, they could have stayed at home relatively easily. The Italian state has no power to force them to come over. On the other hand, if they want to be able to return to Italy one day, if they have family in Italy, there are obviously advantages to answering their call-up papers. It's not the only contribution that Italians are making from overseas. They're also fundraising all across the USA, in South America, all around the world. We can see, you know, balls, parties, various different kind of charitable events, newspaper subscriptions, all kinds of activities to try to raise money for the Italian war effort. Some of it's going to the Italian Red Cross. Some of it's literally people sending checks to the Italian government to support the war effort that way. So Italians outside of Italy are really trying to support the war effort in a number of different ways. The 300,000 men who come back and fight, if you consider that something like 4 million men in total, 4 to 5 million men get called up, 300,000 is a significant share of that, right? It's about the same contribution as is made by the colonial troops in the French army, which are certainly considered historically a significant group. So the contribution of returned emigrants is important. The contribution of the Italians staying overseas, Italian women and other civilians, is important too. Why did I say this is linked to imperialism? Well, the Italians have, in this period, a really unusual and interesting conception of diaspora as a kind of alternate colonialism. And I've given you this quotation from Luigi Einaudi. He would later be the president of the Republic. He's a very distinguished figure. And he was among the many liberals who in the pre-First World War period thought that emigration could be a way for Italy to expand its influence globally, comparable to a colonial empire. So he said, across the Atlantic, a new Italy is growing, which will prove to the world that the imperialist ideal is not destined to remain solely an Anglo-Saxon ideal. On the contrary, we're showing the world that Italy is capable of creating a type of colonization more perfect, more evolved than the Anglo-Saxon type. So what he really means is that this is an empire of emigrants, of trade, a kind of civil empire, rather than an empire of conquest, which is of course what's happening in Libya. This is going to be a kind of informal, tacit empire, almost, I suppose we would say, soft power today, but that nonetheless, this could be a way for Italy to expand its power globally. And many Italians in this period thought of the diaspora as a kind of empire. One scholar has called it ethnographic colonialism. Another has used the word of diasporic colonialism, but it's this idea that those emigrants were in some kind of way part of the Italian Empire. And there's a great phrase of many little Italies making one greater Italy. And so if we talk about What contribution does the Italian Empire make to the First World War? These diaspora Italians are actually part of that story. However, they don't make nearly as much of a contribution as many Italians hoped, because of course there are rival focuses for loyalty. And in particular, for the many, many Italians who are in the United States, many of them are just more interested in and more developing more loyalty to the United States, particularly once the USA joins the war. So instead of being little agents of Italy out there in the wider world, these Italian diaspora groups, these emigrants, are beginning instead to Americanize or Argentinize or wherever it is that they might be, to develop greater ties to their new nations. And these are both just examples of how Italians in the US are moving much more towards identifying as Americans, or at least Italian Americans, rather than as just Italians. So it's not actually a very successful model of creating an empire. So just to conclude, what are the legacies of the war? Well, one of the legacies that I think is really important relates precisely to this issue of what does the Italian Empire look like? Can it be a diaspora colonial empire? Can immigrants spread Italian power through the world? Well, in the war, they don't make as much of a contribution as people had hoped, as the supporters of this model had hoped. They don't all flock back, right? Far more Italian men of military age stay where they are or serve in other allied armies instead of coming back to fight for the motherland. Yes, there's lots of fundraising. No, it's not as much as people had hoped for. So this is in a way the death blow to this idea of diaspora colonialism, this idea that Italy could extend its global power through emigration. And it's a sort of decisive turn towards the traditional idea of a conquest-based empire. When Italy embarks on its next round of imperialism in the 20s and 30s, it's very much all about conquest. And the Italian state is never really as interested in its emigrants and in its diaspora ever again. It really knocks that idea on the head. So I think that's a very important legacy for Italy and the wider world. More directly and more immediately, one of the legacies of the mutilated victory and of the expedition to Fiume is, of course, the rise of fascism. The move towards this really frustrated form of nationalism that we see at the end of the war is one of the things that feeds directly into the beginning of the fascist movement. So does this sense of internal division, of unprecedented disunity. Those new minority populations, the Slavs and the Germans in those new areas that have been incorporated into Italy at the end of the war, they are going to suffer quite brutal programs of forced Italianization, starting already in 1919, 1920, before the fascists even come to power. There's an effort to eliminate these internal minorities, which are seen as so problematic. And that is another thing that's pushing us directly into the fascist era. So the legacies of the imperial expansionist aspect of the war take us right up to the rise of Mussolini and the beginning of obviously a whole new cycle of war and fascism. I'm going to stop there. Thank you.
Dr. Wilcox, thank you so much. If we were surrounded by everybody watching us virtually, I know you'd be hearing a thunderous round of applause. And I will say, for anybody that has a question for Dr. Wilcox, you can type them into the chat box if you're on Facebook, and then there's the question and answer box on Zoom, and we'll be able to answer questions through there. I'm going to be very selfish and take the first opportunity to ask Dr. Wilcox a question, and that is, could you repeat the name of your new book and where folks can pick it up?
I can. I probably even have a copy. Okay. So, okay, with my nice poster, it's The Italian Empire and the Great War. It's published by Oxford University Press, and you should be able to get it in all good bookshops and probably some bad shops as well. But you can definitely get it from Oxford University Press online website, and they can also sell you an ebook. Although I think it's nice to have the cover. I'm not saying that the cover is the best bit about the book, but the cover is definitely one of the best bits about the book.
It is, it's an excellent piece, not only for reading, but for having. I'll say that it is, as someone who thankfully has it on his desk already. But we have some amazing questions rolling in. And the first one comes from Angela Peters. And she asks, what part, if any, did the Vatican play during Italy's war effort during World War I?
Well, this is a really interesting question, actually. Having the Vatican inside Italian territory does create some problems. So the Vatican tries to remain neutral because there's Catholic countries fighting on both sides. But many Italians are very suspicious that the Pope is kind of Austrophile, that he supports the Austrian cause, and that he's kind of that way leaning. What the Vatican does to deal with this and to try and maintain its own neutrality is it creates a dedicated, basically, bishop for the war who has a responsibility for dealing with patriotic and war-related issues, so that then the Vatican kind of put that at arm's length, at least officially, so that the Pope isn't seen as being directly involved. But it's only partially successful. And particularly in the imperial context, there's really interesting links between the Vatican's own private banks and the Italian finance complex, which had invested heavily in imperialism. And many of the people who led Italian imperial investment are actually closely tied to the Vatican. So it can kind of get quite messy, in fact. So it's a really interesting question.
And this next one starts what I'm sure will be a series, given the fact that we are the United States National World War I Museum and Memorial. This comes from someone who says she's writing from a small town in Wisconsin, a town of close to 3,000 people that still has a vibrant Italian-American community to this day. So she was wondering as to why so many Italians may have left for the United States and why immigration was such a massive movement in the Italian diaspora leading up to the war.
It's basically economic. It's primarily economic. And the truth is, I mean, the stereotype is that most immigrants are from the South, but in reality, that's not even true. Immigrants come from all parts of Italy. Immigrants left rural Italy because it was really grindingly poor. And in a country where people had very large families, the family farm might be able to feed one or two of the kids when they grew up, but all the younger children had to leave and make their way in the world, basically. So the main driver is financial. But this is one of the reasons why it's often kind of temporary emigration. So people would go and maybe work in the USA or somewhere else for 5 years, save up a lot of money, and then go back home and get married and be able to buy a house with the money that they'd earned overseas, right? So there's a clear sense that many of them do still feel tied to Italy and they still feel Italian. Some of them obviously are going to meet a girl over in America and stay and get married and make a new life. But some of them deliberately see this as just a temporary affair and they're sending money home to their families. You know, this is actually a really big line in the Italian national income in the years after the war is remittance payments. So emigrants sending cash home to their families is actually so significant that, you know, I think it's like 2 or 3% of gross national income. It's a really major issue. But it really boils down to money.
That's a fabulous answer. And going off on the same theme as well, Demetrio Leone, and I hope I pronounce your name correctly, said, thank you so much for the talk. And again, regarding the Italians abroad and their effort in the war, could it be that they joined the war effort in such numbers because they were not fully integrated in the country that they immigrated to?
Yeah, and this is one of the things that I think is quite interesting. In some countries, Italians kind of integrated more into the wider community, and in others, they kept themselves to themselves more and were more kind of distinct immigrant groups. And I think that where they had remained as distinct immigrant groups, they would quite often be very easy to mobilize for the war effort. You know, there's some places where literally the Italian consul calls a meeting and says, right, we're going to do fundraising and you're all going to volunteer and I'm going to put you down for this money, right? So it can be quite organized. In other places, if people have really integrated into their local communities, they're not necessarily going to support the Italian war effort. They might support, you know, the local war effort of the country that they're living in, right?
So kind of on the flip side of that, Thomas Howell was wondering about non-Italians serving in the Italian army. Were there minorities serving in the Italian army? And by minorities, he specifies groups such as the Germans, Slovenes, or even Croats. And if so, to what proportions? And were they on board with a war of unity?
Hardly any, basically. And one of the big reasons why there's, by the time Italy joins the war, there's not that many minorities in the country, even, because they've all gone home, because the war's been going on for 9 months, right? So if you were French or British, right, you would have probably been called up and to go back to your home country. Many of the of Germans or Austrians who are living there also do. There are some who are still there. They are pretty much immediately interned. They're not welcomed into the Italian army. The Italian army does not welcome volunteers. It is a conscript army. There are in total about 8,000 volunteers. That's it, in an army of several million, because basically it thinks there's a bit something a bit sus about volunteering. Like, why would you do that? It prefers to rely on conscription, and it knows why you're there. You're there because you've been called up. If you volunteer, it suggests that there's something a bit wrong with you. So it's a slightly weird mentality, but there's a lot of evidence that those few people who did volunteer, and basically they volunteer because they're too young to get their call-up papers, right? That's the only reason for it. But those people who do volunteer are treated with prejudice and suspicion. So certainly foreigners who tried to volunteer for the Italian army would not have been welcomed at all.
Well, so then kind of taking it back into Italy itself and the regions of Italy, you went into great detail about how Italy was a relatively new nation. So Johanna Stambeck, who says hello from Stockholm, Sweden, wants to know is, was there any division between the German-speaking parts of Italy as it were then? Does that remain today? And if so, would you say that that division is a heritage from World War I?
Oh, for sure. It's especially the area around Trento, the Trentino and Alto Adige area, so that border area there. It's a fascinating place to go and visit because you really see the Germanic kind of cultural heritage. You see it in the food, right? You get these very Germanic style traditional dishes. It doesn't really feel in a lot of ways like you're in Italy. It feels like you could be in Austria. And there are still places where it's highly controversial. There's the war memorial in the city of Bolzano has to be kept basically behind an electric fence and under 24-hour guard because it still gets vandalized as a sign of like forced Italianization. There's still members of the local population who resent this as a kind of imperial acquisition. And there's a political party which are separatist in that region. So yeah, this is one of the legacies of the war which is still very live.
Definitely, we'll add that to yet another one of the list of how World War I changed us.
For sure.
Going now from the top of the boot to the bottom, Lawrence Hamill was wondering, were the Sicilians as interested and committed to the war effort as others, or did Sicilians still not believe themselves as part of the nation?
Yeah, very much so. So in general, for a population which still has a high rate of illiteracy, which still has people feeling very much connected to their local areas, many of the poorest classes, and especially in rural areas, didn't feel very Italian necessarily. Middle-class people, educated people, yes, they'd been through school, they'd been kind of mobilized into Italianness. But Sicily is a really interesting example. Sicily has very high rates of draft evasion, and partly that's because it was easy, right? You could go into the Sicilian mountains, you could go into hiding, nobody could find you. There'd be enough people that would help feed you and house you. You could just hide from the authorities relatively easily. But also Sicilians didn't feel this to be anything to do with them. And the people who do go up and fight from Sicily and from other parts of the south, they get there and they're like, why are we trying to conquer these rocks? What is this even for, right? This is a sort of rocky frontland that people are not motivated to fight for. And the Italian government doesn't do a great job of explaining to the people of Sicily or other more remote regions why they should care, why they should be involved. So they absolutely are less motivated, especially for the first few years of the war. At the end, when the Austrians occupy part of Italy, then it becomes a little bit easier to motivate people. But in general, no, the Sicilians are not that keen.
So one other question we have is from Sasha Todorov, and he was wondering, to what degree did the result of this soft colonization via immigration being heavily driven by rural Italians and hard nationalism being associated with urban Italians, was there anything connected to the immigration of rural Italians as compared to the strong national identity formed by urban Italians?
Wow, that's complicated. Well, actually, one of the paradoxical things that happens is that when Italian emigrants go overseas, they often feel unprecedentedly Italian. But this happens to a lot of us, right? You go on holiday and you don't feel, you suddenly realize just how much you are British or American or whatever when you're out of your home context and you look at the people around you and you go, actually, do you know what? I really like those guys back home. This happens a lot to Italians. They start to use standard Italian for the first time instead of dialect in America because they have to speak, they want to speak to other Italian immigrants there. So actually, national identity can be strengthened paradoxically by immigration. But just because you feel Italian doesn't necessarily mean that you support the war effort. There's plenty of Italian anarchists and socialists in the USA. Think of Sacco and Vanzetti just a few years later, right? So being Italian doesn't necessarily mean that you want to go off and fight for Italy.
Well, that is all the time we have today. I will say that you have gotten a very warm welcome to Cumberland, Wisconsin, if you want to visit the Italian-American community there.
I'd love to.
And of course, as well, we would love to see you here in Kansas City. Any final words for our viewers today and for the those who check in with us on YouTube in the future?
Well, it was an absolute pleasure coming to speak to you. It's a huge topic, so I've only kind of touched on some of it, but I hope it inspires you to go and find out more about this, I think, really interesting part of the First World War.
Well, I couldn't have said it any better. You are the expert. Thank you so much for joining us. And thank you for everyone viewing us with us, whether you're on Facebook or on Zoom. We hope to see you next time at our next edition of World War I Changed Us. Have a great day.